Here are 40 projects that you can do to learn or master programming. If you're job searching, creating a dashboard to see what jobs you've applied for, track how it's going, is actually pretty practical. You can develop a CLI app, mobile application, or web application. This would be a great way to learn about cron jobs, databases, and maybe some user interface design. Everything is a distraction nowadays. Let's be honest, this video probably is too. But developing a software that enables certain things on your phone or computer, like disabling certain websites, apps, and notifications, is a great way to automate a common workflow and learn third-party SDKs. Honestly, pretty goated. Editing videos takes a significantly long time to make, and one of the worst parts is chopping the video up into usable parts. You can build a software that inputs a video or MP3 and detects a certain threshold of silence and have it cut to export in a video editing software for you to finish up. And like sprinkle a bit of AI in there and you're having a lot of fun now. Whiteboard softwares, they're all over the place, okay? But you can make one that's interactive pretty easily. You can use open source softwares like TLDraw. Then the multiplayer aspect, use WebSockets or something easier like PartyKit. This one can be tough depending on what you kind of want to do with the software, but it's a great starting point to develop something that's custom to you. I have to say it, a task manager. I'm sorry. Now, a to-do application, it's not complex. It's actually probably really easy, but the thing is, it's different for everybody. Most apps are slow because they tailor to everybody, but you only have to build it for yourself. I know every YouTuber suggests to do this, but it's there for a reason. It teaches state, UI development, CRUD, API design, more. Like, it's goated for a reason. Now, the AI chat, it's everywhere. ChatGPT, Claude, Mistral. Like, it's everywhere. Like, what's going on here? Since AI isn't going away anytime soon, this would be a great way to play around with the APIs with modern day large language models. Have some sort of anime role playing component to it. Maybe make a game out of it. The chat is not going away anytime soon, okay? For any type of project you'll run into, you'll need some sort of test data or even real data to grab. Although there's a lot of open source data sets you can use, there's a huge benefit to building a web scraper for your specific needs. Now, the difficulty in this isn't necessarily in the programming part, it's more so the network aspect. So use a proxy like Bright Data or something and you'll be off to the races. Having a personal website feels so old school nowadays, like no one builds it, but it's truly the only way to build something truly for yourself. Wow. Spotify player? Sure. Raining text? Sure. A blog article about literally anything? Sure. The personal website ranges from easy to hard, but that's the beauty in it. You get to pick that. Now, one of the go-to things about mobile applications is the access to the GPS system. Here's some ideas. A hiking app that tracks what trails you went on and gives insights on it. A mileage tracker application that you have on during trips. Android and Apple both have SDKs designed around doing this, with Google having an expensive API for the web, but this would be really useful, especially if that's the feature that you need. Now, I'm calling this glue software, okay? And what I mean by this is that you need to glue one software into another. Let me explain. Gluing Notion and Google Docs together, or Todoist and Obsidian. Most apps you use have an API that you can just get a hold of. And so you're gluing that on to another software that you can integrate into, which is another software you might use. It's honestly one of the first things you do when you're programming. A mental health check app. Daily, you insert how you're feeling and what you did to make yourself feel good, and you log it in daily with some sort of cool dashboard. The benefit of this is privacy. You don't want to let some corporate entity know that you had a mental breakdown while eating cake for the 10th time today. Just me? Just me? Okay, sorry. This app incorporates storing data, user interface, and charting. All great things that you can do. DeepSeek R1, OpenAI O1, Claude 3.7 Sonnet, whatever. Very, very smart models, but they need data centers to run. You can take a very small version of this model and tweak the parameters of it with your own data to be better at a specific task like SQL generation or storytelling. Unsloth is my favorite way to do this, and you don't need a NVIDIA 5090 like I do. You can just do it in a Google Collab. This is often another simple project you see YouTubers tell you to build, but it's honestly pretty handy. An expense tracker can be handled in many ways, either through a simple form that is then crunched in the backend or through other integrations like taking pictures and using OCR to detect receipts. So no matter what level of programmer you are, you'll find something to occupy your peanut brain. Sorry. One second. Rest in peace to Omnivore. So a bookmark manager is something you can build to keep track of these links. Similar to a lot of the items above, it's just a CRUD app. Easy, but how do you extend it? AI categorization, a mobile app, a browser extension to fast save into your database. There's so much possibilities with this. One of my favorite genres on YouTube is the devlogs by game devs on YouTube. Creating a game is both extremely hard, but the easiest it's ever been, I guess. Game engines like Unreal, Unity, and open source Godot have great communities and support. Building a game has a ton of concepts that you need to dive into outside of even programming to get into. But getting started and seeing a concept coming to life is, you can't beat that feeling. It's honestly awesome. It's me from the future. One of the fastest way to get started on an app is getting Lovable.dev to get the project started for you. Lovable is an AI-powered platform that allows you to create a full-stack application using natural language. Or if you're like me, you can use a Figma file, or you can literally draw it yourself and get something that looks pretty close to what you drew. And you can see it be built in real time. But my favorite part is that you can actually make something with real functionality by connecting a SUPA-based backend, as well as edit the source code in dev mode. But of course, since we're devs and we have our own kind of configurations that we like, we can actually get the source code ourselves from GitHub, where I 100% own the code that is generated. Now, I'm not a designer, if you couldn't tell already. But I do love being able to generate a nice UI that functions really well with modern standards to accompany my backend code. You can integrate it with popular services like GitHub, Stripe, Resend, Clerk, and a whole lot more. As long as it has an open API spec, you're basically good to go. Thanks to Lovable for sponsoring today's video. If you're interested in giving it a try, make sure you check out the link in the description. If you don't want to start out at that foundational level, sometimes building a game within a game makes sense as a starter project. Things like Roblox are popular for starting your games. Modding Minecraft with Java could also be a fun way to start, and there's a lot more. This is a little bit more niche than building your own game because it's building something that you use already, but it can honestly go a long way. Now, the knowledge base is just a note-taking app, but it kind of is organized in a different way. Some like to specify by tags, while others like nodes in a graph. Sometimes it's just a folder. This might be one of the easiest things that you develop on this whole entire list, to be honest, but it has the most room for expansion because everyone's different. Let's find out how you like to store your notes by building it yourself. PDF to docs, MP4 to MOV, JPEG to PNG. There's a lot of ways you can turn one file into another file type. Now, the best way is to get some sort of open source software like FFmpeg to do this process for you that's been around for years. But an idea is that you can build a better interface that uses FFmpeg in the background in order to facilitate this. Or perhaps setting an automation when something automatically goes into a folder. The world of possibilities for this is honestly endless. Tooling, software you use in the process of developing an application, like linting, building, or just like automating any process in your development journey. The JavaScript devs live for this, but somewhere in your projects, you can automate an annoying task. In fact, others might share this annoying task. Structuring your Python code a certain way, checking something before committing to a Git repository. There's a lot of things you can do, but everyone has one. Okay, don't wet yourself, okay? Clean yourself up. I know this sounds intimidating, but it's not. The AI, before it started speaking in waifu to you, goes back a while, and things like TensorFlow has made it easy to get started. So you can build a neural network that understands certain bird pictures, what bird it is, or what sound it makes. It's honestly not as hard as it looks. And these models are often so small they can run on smart devices, even Raspberry Pis. Emails, they come in and they are always crap. Let's be real here, I don't care. You can pull your email provider or use a webhook, but when they come in, find a way to intelligently sort them into a way that works for you. Going back to the glue that I was talking about back there, you can find a way to automate this with your other softwares just by using the email keywords. Something that is tough is dealing with a large amount of data, especially when you're trying to search for it. Video editing, accounting, photos. Thanks to popular vision models, you can easily get the information on something like a video, image, or text document. That means you can create a search application for a niche data set that you have, and it is pretty easy. Everyone does productivity differently. The Pomodoro technique consists of 25 minutes of hard work, 5 minutes break. Repeat this 2 or 3 times and then get a 30 minute break. Now, a lot of programmers want to do a lot more than 25 minutes of programming, so extend that. Find a way to reward them once the timer ends. Again, this is all about you, no one else. Now, this is a fun project to do with a lot of wasted time, okay? But go to the documentation of older devices and see if you can bring something modern to it. So I have this Macintosh Plus right here that's from the 1980s. And looking at its manual, it's advanced, scary stuff. Seeing people bring Minecraft on YouTube to graphing calculators or cheap technology is a fun challenge in education on how lower level programming works. This would probably go along with the other apps that you have, but taking a large data set that consists of time and graphing it through a time series database. Use this as a learning method to do some complex queries and graphing of multiple charts. Timescale DB or Influx are popular examples that you could use on GitHub, but I mean, there's a ton. Okay, I know this is technically hardware, but a lot of the aspects of these IoT machines is the software. You can use something like a Raspberry Pi or Arduino with different sensors to measure the temperature, the weight of something, or anything you can get your dirty hands on. Sorry, that was a bit mean. In fact, this could also be used to gather the data of your time series database or notification system. A static site generator, it turns static assets like markdown files, images, whatever, into a HTML document that is then deployed on the web. Multiple parts go into this, like translating different text formats into HTML, setting up a server for it to run off of, theming of the website, property handling. There's already a lot of great options that you can find on GitHub, but this might honestly be a great way for you to build a website for a client or maybe even your own personal website or blog. Remember when we talked about AI chat? Well, this is similar, except you need friends in order to continue this. Now, a chat UI is simple to build, but where things get tough is authentication and real-time connections. You'll learn about WebSockets, authentication, state management, and more. And since one of the hardest part of this is dealing with the real-time connections, you can build clients in your CLI tool if needed. It's very flexible, but typical, lots of tutorials online. Now, unless you're like a real pro, don't use this in production, but honestly, if you're learning one of these new fast programming languages, a API gateway might honestly be a great way to learn. Whenever an HTTP request comes in, the API gateway has to route it to a certain server based on specific rules given, like if it's up. This is definitely a more advanced project, but honestly, you'll learn a lot from it. Now, this is another popular application aimed at beginners, but the URL shortener takes a URL and shortens it significantly. That was a bit hard to say. What's actually being done though, is that you're setting a URL to your own servers so that you can redirect it to another one. It's a very smart idea and can have some network complexities, but it's a great way for learning a new backend framework language. Watching YouTube videos together can be a pain when in a call. So if you set up a desktop or web application, you can embed the video inside and use a WebSocket connection to control the state of the video player between all clients. I actually built something like this on my YouTube channel before, and it's actually a lot of fun. You can mimic existing services like Discord or ones on the web, but it's up to you. No, I don't mean start programming and no paste editors. I just mean create a way for you to automate simple tasks using a custom built node-based editor that you built. Do you understand what I'm saying here? Coding is great, but the idea of blocks you can just quickly add in and iterate over can be a powerful tool. NodeZater for Python, React Flow for the web, or MGUI Node Editor are all good options. In whatever code editor you use, create an extension to help you with a tedious task, or just to have a buddy to help keep you motivated. And what's great with this idea is that you can actually get some good feedback because of the marketplace that exists in these code editors. People can just download them easily. And depending on where you code, you're going to touch up on the doc to see how it can integrate, but since it already has users, it's a quick way to get user feedback. This is also a simple application and another YouTube favorite. It's fairly straightforward, a website that lets you view all the weather updates in multiple places. You'll learn how to interact with HTTP requests and APIs. You can up the stakes by doing cron jobs and storing data so you can do a time series, but this is as straightforward as it gets. Since Google Chrome wants to get rid of ad blockers, an ethical ad blocker can be a pretty tough task to do actually, because of how much you have to update it with different sources. The interesting part though will be the network code that you put in your browser or device that blocks out connections from these sources. And this is where you'll start seeing a lot of nuance. Like for example, some pages will not load without that tracker, so you kind of fuzzy up the data instead. It just requires a lot of time and effort, but it's a really interesting thing, especially right now. For web developers out there, creating a sleek user interface is often just something a lot of us want to avoid. How can you make a tooltip much more engaging to a user? Can you make a side-by-side image viewer? How about a color picker? Usually you just run an NPM install and whatever comes up, you're just gonna use it. But this actually might be a good way to get all the intricacies and the nuance behind some of the designs of these items. On the cutting edge of the AI scene, an AI agent is a AI that reasons for a second and then does an action for you. It's basically as easy as that. Now, be cautious with this one, okay? There's a lot of projects out there that claim to be like, you know, the AI agent framework, but all you need is an OpenAI API key, Ollama, and that's about it. There's lots of other tech affiliated with this, like vector databases, but just seeing how silly it can get is honestly worth it on its own. This one is a little bit abstract, okay? But whether it's for a simulator, game, textures for 3D models, the idea of procedurally generating something is an interesting idea just to play around with. Now, the way I would define this, I guess, is you would be creating a visual asset of some sort that incorporates some sort of variable of random. So like a different map in a game, a different texture on a skin. You can build some really cool things out of this, but it also depends on what you are using it for. Now, a physics simulation, it has no business being fun whatsoever, but oh man, it's awesome. In most programming language, you'll have a framework used to render things on screen. And after that, the world is yours. Like a world simulation, water, particles. This area is massive and you can go really high level by using an existing game engine like Unreal, or going really low level and start experimenting with graphics programming, which that's tough, okay? That is tough. Passwords are very important, but very insecure. A password manager generates, encrypts, and stores your passwords so you can use them easily and securely everywhere you go. Now, this one is definitely a lot tougher than the other ones on the list. You should definitely use an authentication algorithm so you don't learn the hard way that you're just an insecure little boy. I added that last part on, sorry about that. This is fun if you're entering a cybersecurity end of things. What projects are you working on? Let me know in the comments and check out how Discord scaled to one of the biggest servers ever. Honestly, maybe some inspiration for your next project. Peace out, coders.